Yeah, thank you very much for this introduction and for inviting us here. I think this workshop is a wonderful idea, and it's a great pleasure for me to sharing here the first session. And the first speaker is Jill Kahn, and the title of his talk is Time-Resolved Diagnostics of Reactive Pulsed Plasmas by Absorption Spectroscopy, Modulated Beam Mass Spectroscopy, Ion Flux Probe, and Retarding Field Energy Analyzers.
Now it counts. So thank you, Yuri. And of course, I'd like first to thank the organizing committee who gave me the opportunity to give this talk and to come back to Dublin. And I'm very happy to be here again. So my talk today, of course, will be on time-resolved diagnostics of pulse plasmas, etching processes. So I've shortened the title. My French co-workers are indicated here. And the work was also done in collaboration with Nick Braithwaite from the Open University, Oxford, with David Gann from Impedance, and with Samer Bana from Applied Materials, USA. So this talk deals with plasma etching processes, and I will start by a short, very short introduction on etching. And for example, if you take silicon etching in chlorine oxygen plasmas, well, actually, in this chemistry, the chlorine atoms formed in the plasma are going to etch the silicon surface by forming SiCl4 volatile etch products that are pumped out of the chamber. And I underline here that this process is strongly assisted by the energetic ion bombardment of the surface. Now, of course, as you know, plasma etching is interesting because it can be anisotropic, which means that the etching goes in the vertical direction only. And this is possible because the ion bombardment is directional, and also because we adjust the plasma chemistry to form a passivation layer on the feature sidewalls, and those passivation layers prevent the sidewall from lateral etching, so we go only in the vertical direction. Now, another interest of plasma etching is that it can be selective, which means that in this case the silicon is etched but not the oxide, and this is interesting because it allows you to stop on a very thin layer when you are doing the etching. Now, why are we interested in pulsed ICP plasmas for etching applications today? So the motivation is that the microelectronic industry is more and more challenged by the fabrication and the miniaturization of integrated circuits. And today, it's necessary to etch nanostructures in very complicated stacks of ultra-thin layers, and sometimes in three dimensions. And as a matter of fact, the typical high-density plasma reactors that you are using to do this show some severe limitations to do those structures, so both in terms of anisotropy and of selectivity. Now, I will show you two important limitations of CW plasmas. So first limitation is known as ion-induced damages. And as a matter of fact, the surfaces that are bombarded by energetic ions are damaged, and the thickness of the damaged layer is about 3 nanometers, which is quite a lot for us. And this is a very serious issue to etch stacks of ultra-thin layers. And for example, when you are doing silicon gate etching, it's very difficult to prevent the consumption of the underlayer. And in this case, it's dramatic because this underlayer was only 5 or 7 nanometers thick initially. So if you hit 3 nanometers here, it's already half of the thickness of the layer. So this is a serious issue, but we can't do anything against it because in a high-density plasma, the ion energy is always larger than the plasma potential, which means it's higher than 15 eV. So there is no solution to this problem. Now, another limitation of CW plasma are the well-known charging effects. So they come from the fact that the ion bombardment is perpendicular to the surface, while the electron bombardment is isotropic. And as a result, the top of the features is going to charge negatively, while their bottom charges positively. And due to this differential charging, the ions are slowed down and are deviated towards the sidewalls, leading to some profile control issues, such as bowing here or notching, or some issues like you can see here. So from those two examples, you can see already that today's etching processes are not adapted to nanometric dimension, being vertical nor lateral, and that we need new plasma sources with more control knobs to tune the plasma chemistry, the ion flux, and the ion energy. And this is why we are interested in pulse plasmas. Now, what is a pulsed ICP plasma and what would we like to know about those guys? Well, first of all, let me remind you that in a typical HDP etching reactor, we have two RF power supply. So the first one is inductively coupled to the plasma and is used to generate a high density plasma in the chamber. And the second power supply, known as a bias power, is capacitively coupled to the electrode and is used to control the ion energy that bombards the wafer. Now, a pulsed ICP plasma is simply obtained by modulating the ICP power on and off periodically, as shown here. And now, when you do this, regarding the second power supply, we have two possibilities. So first, if our goal is to minimize the ion energy on the wafer, it will be simply switched off, as shown here. But on the other hand, if we need energetic ion bombardment on the wafer, we can switch this power, this bias power on, and it can be pulsed in phase with the ICP power. And in this case, I will refer to synchronized pulse plasmas. Now, what you see here is that, of course, we can control the frequency of the plasma pulses and their duty cycle. And the duty cycle is actually the percentage of time during which the RF is on. So we can control those two things. And by pulsing the plasma, we have those two new knobs to tune an etching process, the pulsing frequency and the duty cycle. And if we want to use those knobs efficiently to design etching processes, we have to understand what is their impact on the radical fluxes, the ion flux, and the ion energy. And this is why we want to use time-resolved plasma diagnostics. So, very generally, I am showing here the basic principle and apparatus that are necessary to do time-resolved measurement in pulse plasmas. And this is a very general schematics. So, all the plasma diagnostic techniques are going to provide us a signal, that is to say, typically, a current that will be proportional, for example, to the ion flux. And our goal is to capture the variation of this signal during one plasma pulsing period, which typically lasts about 100 microseconds when the plasma is pulsed at 10 kHz. And of course, to do this, what we need is a fast acquisition system that is synchronized with the plasma pulses in order to record the signal during the pulsing period here. And we have been working with that since 5 years. And basically, for both acquisition system, the choice of the system will depend on the nature of the signal. So if you want to detect continuous wave signals, well, the best choice is clearly an analog digital converter that will perform much better than any oscilloscope thanks to its 16-bit dynamic range. Now, in contrast, if the signal here consists of pulses of current, then we have to use what is called a multi-channel analyzer, or something that people also call sometimes a photon counter. And I will be back to this later. So now I will focus on the diagnostic techniques. And to begin with, I would like to discuss about radical density measurements by broadband UV absorption spectroscopy. So the principle of absorption spectroscopy is shown here. So basically, we are using a xenon arc as the light source. And the light beam is passing through the plasma chamber, and its intensity is measured by a monochromator backed with a photodiode array. And the transmitted intensity, IT, is going to be lower than the initial intensity, I0, because some photons of the beam have been absorbed by the plasma radicals. And as you know, IT and I0 are related by the Beer-Lambert law of absorption, which says that I0 decay exponentially with the absorbing species density, N, with the plasma size, L, and with the absorption cross-section alpha. So by measuring IT and I0, we can get the radical density N. And for example, I'm showing here an absorption spectrum that was measured during silicon etching by a chlorine discharge. And you can see here absorbing bands of SiO, silicon, SiCl, and SiCl2 H products. And of course, from this spectrum, we can get the absolute density of those species. But I underline here that the absorbance is typically very small, about 10 to the minus 3. And therefore, high sensitivity is required to measure it. And this is why, about 5 years ago, we have introduced UV LEDs as a light source to replace xenon arcs. So I will just say a few words about UV LEDs. So this is the LED, and basically they covered all the spectral range between 240 nanometers and 1.5 micron with a significant power. And as you can see here, each LED has a spectral width of about 15 to 20 nanometers. Now, the important point with LEDs is that they are solid-state light sources, which means that they will provide a very bright light point without intensity fluctuation when the LED is properly thermoregulated and fed by a stabilized current source. And for example, I am showing here the stability characterization of a LED. So this curve here is the LED emission spectrum. So this is a 255 nanometer LED. And we did twice the same measurement with a 5-minute interval. And then we divide them by each other to get this unabsorbed baseline that is shown here in red. And you can see that this baseline is perfectly flat and has a value of 1, which means that the LED intensity is perfectly stable. And therefore, thanks to LEDs, absorbances of 10 to the minus 4 can be readily measured today. And it's the key to do time-resolved measurements. So let's look now at the time-resolved measurements by absorption with LED impulse discharge. So actually, the issue here is that a time resolution better than 100 microseconds is required. And therefore, of course, we cannot do a single pass measurement, but we have to accumulate the signal over many plasma pulsing periods. And fortunately, this can be done with a LED because its intensity is extremely stable, so we can accumulate the signal without drift. Now, in this experiment, the light that is going out of the chamber is captured by an optical fiber, injected in a monochromator, detected by a PM tube, and then this current here is amplified and detected by the analog digital. And as I said before, to do time-resolved measurement in pulse plasmas, the AD here is synchronized with the plasma pulses, thus measuring the transmitted intensity IT over each pulsing period and accumulating this signal until a good signal-to-noise ratio is achieved. And for example, I'm showing here the time variation of the Cl2 molecule densities in a pulsed Cl2 plasma. So this is the on and the off period here. And of course, in the on period, the Cl2 density decreases because Cl2 molecules are destroyed by electron impact collisions. And in the afterglow, when the RF is off, the Cl2 density is increasing because Cl2 is produced from the recombination of chlorine atom on the reactor walls. And I will come back to this result later. So we can detect quite a lot of small radicals with this technique, but of course not all of them. And to detect more species by absorption spectroscopy, well, we have 2 years ago, we have extended the technique to the vacuum UV domain by using deuterium light sources. So now we are doing absorption in a wavelength around 115 and 200 nanometers. So actually, we found in the literature that many closed shell molecules that are relevant for processing have strong absorbing bonds toward Rydberg states in the vacuum UV domain. And for example, I'm showing here the absorption spectrum of HBr gas, so this is measured without plasma, with various pressure of HBr in the reactor. And you can see that we have very strong absorbing bonds toward Rydberg states. And for instance, the absorbance here is about 80%. So this is just huge. And because the absorbance is huge, the technique is extremely sensitive. We can detect very low density of species. But of course, there is a drawback, which is that the absorption is often what we call saturated, which means that we don't have now a linear relation between the absorbance and the density. So for example, this is the intensity of the absorbance of this peak as a function of the density, and you can see that it's strongly nonlinear. Now, it's not an issue at all because we use this technique only to detect stable gases that can be introduced in the reactor. And therefore, we can always determine the relation between the absorbance and the density from measurement without plasma, exactly as we did here. So it's easy to get the absolute density from the absorbance. Now, for time resolved measurements in the VUV, well, actually, it's almost the same thing as with the LED. So there are only two main differences. We are using a deuterium light lamp source instead of LEDs. And all the optical path, including the monochromator, must be under vacuum to prevent the absorbance from the air. And finally, also one difference is that in the BUV we have to use mirror, that is to say reflective optics, instead of lenses, because they are achromatic. Now, for time-resolved measurements, the acquisition system is exactly identical to the one that I have shown before. And basically, for time-resolved measurements, the analog digital converter is simply synchronized with the plasma pulses, and you thus record the absorbance as a function of time. And for example, this is the time variation of the HBr gas density during one plasma pulse, and again, you can see that HBr decreases in the on period because it's dissociated and increases in the afterglow. And I will come back to that later. So we can detect many more species with this technique, but we still get some important radicals that could not be detected by absorption spectroscopy. And actually, to detect those guys, what we do is to use a technique called modulated beam Fresnel ionization mass spectrometry. And I will describe it, of course, right now. So this is a schematic of a typical mass spectrometer, which principle is quite simple. So basically, the plasma radicals enter in the mass spec through a hole that is located on the reactor walls, typically. And then those radicals are ionized by energetic electrons in the ionization chamber of the mass spectrometer. Then these ions are transported, energy analyzed, mass filtered, and eventually detected by a channeltron coupled to a counting system. So we have to use the counting system here because the output of the channeltron consists of pulses of current. Now, one major difficulty with mass spectrometry is to do what we call the removing the background signal, the background from the signal. And to understand this, I will focus now on what's going on in the ionization chamber of the mass spectrometer. And I will do this in the case, in the simple case of an argon plasma. So, plasma is here, this is the reactor walls, and the argon atoms are going to enter in the mass spectrometer head through an orifice here, and then they are going to be ionized by this electron beam, which energy, of course, can be controlled. Now, when you do mass spectrometry, the assumption that you are doing is that the argon plus signal intensity here is proportional to the argon density in the plasma. And unfortunately, this assumption is generally wrong, simply because a large part of the signal here is originating from the residual pressure of argon atoms in the mass spectrometer head, or in other words, from argon atoms that have bounced several times in the mass spec head before being ionized. And this background signal must be subtracted to capture the beam component, that is to say the signal from argon atoms that have been directly ionized, and it is this beam component that is really proportional to the argon density in the plasma. And to subtract the background signal, we have to use the modulated beam mass spectrometry. So this is not so trivial, I will describe it now. So this is our experimental setup that we are using to do modulated beam mass spectrometry. So it was designed together with Aidan. And you can see here that in our system, the plasma radicals are passing first through a 0.7 millimeter diameter hole. Then they enter in this first chamber here, that is pumped at 150 liters per second by a turbopump. And then those radicals have to pass through a second hole to enter in the ionization chamber. And as you can see here, in between these two holes, we have placed what we call the tuning fork chopper that is shown here in green. And actually, this chopper is oscillating continuously at 10 Hz, and it's going to modulate the beam intensity at this frequency. So, when this chopper here is closed, you can see that, of course, the beam is blocked, and we are going to measure only the background in the mass spec head. And on the other end, when the chopper is open, we are going to measure the beam plus the background contribution. And once you get the background and the beam plus the background, of course, you can subtract the background and get the beam. So let me just show you an example. So this was measured in an oxygen plasma, and this is the signal from oxygen atoms at mass 16 from the O2 plasma. So at the beginning of this experiment, the chopper is open here, and we are going to measure the beam plus the background signal. And here at this point, this is during one chopping period. So at this point, the chopper closes and shut down the beam, and so here we get the background signal, and here the chopper opens again, and we get again the beam plus background, and so on. Now, in this particular example, you can see that the background is extremely small, it's almost negligible, and actually this is because we are measuring oxygen atoms that have a very high sticking probability on the surfaces here, and therefore their pressure in the mass spectrometer head is kept low because they are lost on surfaces. But if we do the same experiments, for example, with oxygen molecules that do not stick on the surfaces, then you can see here that for O2 molecules, the background now is very large and is actually larger than the beam itself, which is simply because those guys don't stick on surfaces and their pressure is going to increase in the mass spectrometer head. So in this case, it's extremely important to subtract the background properly to do a measurement. Now, to subtract the background, we have to do a measurement like those ones, that is to say that we have to measure the signal as a function of time during one chopping period. And to do these measurements, it's quite simple. So what we are doing is that the signal from the channeltron is going to be measured by a multi-channel pulse counter that is triggered at 10 Hz by the chopper. So a multi-channel pulse counter actually is going to divide here the chopping period into 1,000 channels and is going to count the pulses that falls into each of these channels as a function of time. So this pulse counter is going to capture the entire signal during each chopping period, and it allows us to get a very good signal to noise ratio. So now, how to do time-resolved measurement in pulse plasma with mass spectrometry? So basically, we have two requirements. So the first one is that the plasma pulses that are shown here in red must be synchronized with the chopper oscillation that are shown here in blue. And the other obligation is that, of course, we want to have one full plasma pulse that falls when the chopper is open. Now, to do this synchronization, basically what we do is that the chopper signal at 10 Hz is used to trigger a burst generator that is going to produce pulses at a much higher frequency, and these pulses are then used to pulse the ICP power. So, for example, I'm showing you a result. So of course, during that time, the multi-channel pulse counter captures the signal during the chopping period, as before. And for example, I'm showing here the time variation of the signal from chlorine atoms at mass 35 in a Cl2 discharge. And so you can see here that the first plasma pulse falls when the chopper is closed. So we have no signal, we measure the background here. And then the chopper opens, and after a while we get a first plasma pulse. And you can see that when the plasma is on, the chlorine atom density here is increasing. And when the plasma is off in the afterglow, the chlorine density decays. And then we got the next plasma pulse that we don't use because the chopper closed in the middle of it. Now to treat this signal, we are going to select, of course, only one plasma pulsing period here. Then we are going to subtract the background. And finally, the signal will be calibrated on an absolute scale, that is to say, converted from counts per second into absolute density by comparison with the signal coming from a known pressure of argon atoms. Okay. So I have finished now with the diagnostic to detect neutral species, and very briefly I will summarize it. So if we combine absorption spectroscopy and mass spec, basically we can monitor the density of almost all the radicals, even in very complex chemistry. And for example, this is a very nice result. It shows the time variation during the plasma pulse of the SiCl, SiCl2, SiCl3, SiCl4, Cl and Cl2 densities. And of course, it's very interesting to understand the physics of those complicated discharges. Now, what about the ions? So of course, the ions are important. And last year, we have measured the time-resolved ion flux in pulse plasmas by using a capacitively coupled RF planar probe. And I will present now its principle. So it's an old principle. So this technique was developed by Nick Braithwaite and co-workers in 1996. And the principle to measure variant flux in a sea in a continuous wave plasma is to use a planar probe here immersed into the discharge. And this probe is fed by burst of RF through a blocking capacitor. So I'm showing here the RF pulses and in red, the time variation of the probe potential. So of course, when you put some RF in such a system, as you know, the capacitor here is going to charge negatively due to the self-biasing effect. And at the end of the RF pulse here, you can see that the probe surface is polarized or DC biased at minus 40 volts. Therefore, when the RF is switched off here, the electron cannot reach the probe surface because it's polarized to a large negative voltage. And the probe capacitor here is going to discharge by collecting the positive ion bomb flux from the plasma. And therefore, if you are able to measure the capacitor discharge current in the off period here, you get directly the ion flux. So let me just show you how do we measure this current. So basically, as suggested by Jean-Paul Bouffe, we use a direct current measurement system through a 1 kilo-ohm serial resistor. So the experimental setup is shown here in more detail. And in between the pulsed RF generator of the probe and its blocking capacitor, we put the resistor and two diodes in parallel. And basically, with this system, when the RF is on the probe, the RF signal is going to propagate through the diodes and to charge the blocking capacitor. But when the RF is off on the probe, the capacitor discharge current is going to flow only through the resistor. And therefore, it can be measured by the analog digital converter that is triggered by the probe pulses. So it means that we are going to measure the current only in the off period here. And for example, this is the time variation of the probe voltage in blue and of the probe current measured by the AD in red in the off period of the probe. And you can see that initially and during 1 millisecond, the probe is polarized to a large negative voltage, so it collects only the ions. And of course, during that time, the ion current is constant. It's the ion bomb flux that we want to measure, so we get it directly from this part of the characteristic. And then after a while, the probe voltage becomes too low to repel the electrons. The probe starts collecting electrons, and the current drops very rapidly to zero as the probe, which is the floating potential. So the measurement must be done in this part of the characteristic. And now, if we want to do time-resolved measurement in pulse plasmas, well, actually, the system is almost the same. We only have one issue, is that we need several plasma pulses to charge the blocking capacitor to minus 40 volts. And it means that the probe pulsing frequency must be smaller than the plasma pulsing frequency, but of course, they have to be synchronized. So technically, to do this, the plasma is going to be pulsed at the desired frequency, and this signal is going, we are going to trigger a frequency divider by this signal, and this frequency divider, in turn, is going to be used to trigger the probe burst at a 10 times smaller frequency. So I don't know if this is clear, so we show a timing sequence, it may look like that. So in this example, the plasma is pulsed at 2 kilohertz, and it's divided by 10 to feed the probe, and the RF burst on the probe are 200 hertz only. And in green here, I am showing the time variation of the potential of the probe surface. And you can see here that when the RF is on the probe, we need several plasma pulses to polarize the probe to minus 50 volts. And when the RF is off on the probe, the capacitor here is going to discharge by collecting the current from the plasma pulses here. And so the analog digital is directly measuring the time variation of the ion current during the plasma pulses. And if I make a zoom on one of those pulses here, you can see that with this system, we can capture the time variation of the ion flux during one plasma pulse with a 5 microsecond resolution and with an excellent signal to noise ratio. Okay. So it's more than time now to look at some results obtained with all those diagnostics. Yeah, it should be okay. And basically, I will say that we are using an industrial ICP reactor from Applied that is designed to etch 300 millimeter wafers, but that has been modified by our colleagues from Applied to host some plasma and surface diagnostics. So this is located in a clean room, And you can see here, for example, the lead light source that is used for UV absorption spectroscopy, and here the mass spectrometer. And I just want to point out here that this system is equipped with pulsed RF generator that work at constant peak power, which is important to understand the result. And I also underline that the typical pulsing frequency used in the industry for etching application is about 1 to 10 kilohertz, let's say, or 1 to 20 kilohertz. So it's quite high frequency. Okay, so let's move to the results. And I will now discuss first of the impact of the pulsing parameter on the radical densities in those plasmas. So I will start by describing the Cl and Cl2 radical kinetics in chlorine plasmas pulsed at low frequency. So I have just said before that the industry is using high frequency pulsing, but I also underline that low frequency pulsing in the range of 10 to 20 Hz is very interesting to probe the loss kinetic of radicals in the afterglow. So for example, I'm showing here the time variation of the chlorine atom density in red, measured by mass spectrometry, and of the Cl2 density in blue, measured by UV absorption spectroscopy. And basically what's going on here is that when the plasma is on, we get energetic electrons, and Cl2 molecules are dissociated to create chlorine atoms. So in the on period, the Cl2 density decreases, while the chlorine atom density increases. And then, when the RF is switched off, the electron temperature drops very rapidly, so we have no more production of chlorine atoms by electron impact. But on the other hand, the chlorine atoms are lost on the reactor walls, where they recombine to form Cl2. So in the afterglow, the chlorine atom density decays, while the Cl2 density is increasing. And there are two important conclusions here. So the first one is that in a pulse plasma, the reactive radicals are produced only during the on period, but they are lost continuously on the reactor walls. And the other information that is very important, actually, is that you can see here that a significant time scale for significant radical density variation is several milliseconds. Now, when you are going to increase the plasma pulsing frequency, the plasma pulsing period is going to decrease, and for pulsing frequencies above 1 kHz, the pulsing period here will be less than 1 millisecond. And as a result, the radical density is not anymore modulated during the plasma pulse. And this result is evidenced here. So this is the Cl2 density as a function of time during the pulsing period in a plasma that is pulsed at 1 kHz. So the pulsing period is less than 1 millisecond here. And you can see actually that the Cl2 density is completely flat and that it's even difficult to say when the RF is switched off. So the conclusion here is that if you pulse a discharge at high frequency, you don't have to do time-resolved measurement of the radical density during the pulse, and it's good enough to do time-average measurements. And the result that I will present in the next slides are measured like that. So let's look now at the impact of the pulsing parameters, that is to say pulsing frequency and duty cycle, on the radical density. So I'm showing on this slide the chlorine atom density, so time average, as a function of the duty cycle, and for two different pulsing frequencies. And what you can see here is that the duty cycle has a very strong impact on the chlorine atom density, so the chlorine density increases very rapidly when the duty cycle is increased. But that, by contrast, the pulsing frequency has strictly no effect on the radical density. And so, my first conclusion here is that if you pulse a plasma at small duty cycle, the chemical reactivity of the plasma is very reduced. So you have very low density of reactive radicals. And of course, it is because when the plasma is pulsed, the fragmentation of the feedstock gas molecules by electron impact collision is reduced. So to explain this result, I made a very simple schematic here. So I'm showing basically the plasma pulses on and off here, and the time variation of the electron temperature. And the important point here is that the electron temperature drops very rapidly from 3 eV to a low value when the RF is switched off. So it drops in 10 to 20 microseconds here. And therefore, the production of chlorine atom by electron impact collision is going to take place only during the on period when you get energetic electrons. But on the other hand, as I said before, those chlorine atoms are lost continuously on the reactor walls where they produce Cl2, so both in the on and on period. And the obvious consequence of that is that if you increase the duty cycle, the on period here during which the chlorine atoms are produced is going to be longer, and therefore the chlorine atom density is going to be higher. And that's exactly what we see here. Now, by contrast, if you increase the pulsing frequency, so let's say I multiply the pulsing frequency by a factor of 2 here, then you can see that the total on time during which the chlorine atoms are produced is exactly the same as before. And basically, this is why the pulsing frequency has no effect on the radical density in the discharge. It's just because the total on time is the same. So one important conclusion here, very important actually for the design of pulse processes, is that the ratio of atomic to molecular densities can be controlled by the duty cycle. You can control the chemical reactivity of a discharge by playing on the duty cycle, and this is true in any kind of plasma chemistry. So, I will now move to the impact of the pulsing parameters on the ion flux. So very rapidly, let's look at first an electropositive helium plasma. Should be okay. At 10 millitorr. So this is the time variation of the ion flux during the plasma pulse for various duty cycles. And I just point out here that when the RF is off in the afterglow, the ion flux decay first very rapidly because the electron temperature drop, which slows down the boom velocity, and then it drops on a smaller time scale due to ambipolar losses on the reactor walls. Now, the important point is that the rise and fall times of the ion flux is very short, about 10 microseconds, and is much shorter than the pulsing period. In other words, everything is like the ion flux was square wave modulated. And because of that, in the on period, the ion flux almost reaches a steady state, and the flux is high even when the duty cycle is very short. Now, if we look at electronegative plasmas, the same measurements, the result is completely different. And you can see actually that both the rise time and the decay time of the ion flux are much longer than in helium. And this is indeed attributed to the formation of negative ions by electron attachment in the afterglow, and with a negative ion density that is going to increase when the afterglow duration is increased. Now, the consequence is that in the on period, the ion flux strongly depends on the duty cycle and remains extremely small, below 25% of duty cycle. And of course, this is an important conclusion for the design of pulse etching processes, and as I will show now, it has also important consequences on the ion energy that bombards the wafer. So this is the last part of my talk, it's only three slides. So it's the impact of the pulsing parameter on the ion energy distribution function at the wafer surface. So first, I will present the IEDF in pulsed ICP plasmas without bias power. So the IEDF are recorded by a Semion analyzer from Impedance, and David will present it on the next presentation, so I'll jump directly to the results. And I just remind here that without bias power, the ions are accelerated to the wafer only by the plasma potential. So if you are in a CW discharge, VP is about 15 volts. So all the ions here in black in CW discharge have the same energy, which is about 15 eV. But if you go to a pulse discharge, the plasma potential is going to be rapidly modulated between 15 volts in the on period down to about 1 volt in the afterglow. And as a result, the IEDF in pulse discharge are bimodal with a high energy peak at 15 volts, which correspond to the on period, and a low energy peak, which correspond to ion from the afterglow. And of course, if you reduce the duty cycle, if you shorten the on period, the intensity of the high energy peak is going to reduce very rapidly. And therefore, in a plasma pulsed with a small duty cycle, the wafer is bombarded mostly by low energy ion. And this is a key point to reduce damages on ultra-thin surfaces. Now, what's going on in synchronous pulse plasmas in which you have some bias power applied to the wafer to accelerate the ions? So this is the IDF. Again, the blue one is in CW, so you can see that this time all the ions have an energy of about 60 eV, which is due to the fact that we are accelerating them to the wafer. And now if you look at pulse plasmas, you can see that the IEDF are again bimodal, so I will not focus on the ions from the afterglow, which are not interesting here, but the important point is that the ions from the on period have an increasing energy here when the duty cycle is reduced, and this increase is very fast. And actually, the ions here, that when you play with a pulse plasma at 20% duty cycle, have an energy that is 5 times the energy of the ions in the CW plasma for the same bias power. So this is extremely interesting. And actually, it can be explained very easily. So basically, when you put some bias power to bias your wafer, this bias power is equal to the products of the ion current multiplied by the DC self-bias voltage of the electrode. And therefore, if for any reason the ion current drops at constant power, the bias voltage has to increase to compensate. And therefore, the ion energy is going to increase. And this is precisely what happens in a pulse plasma. So I have just shown you before, so this is again the ion flux as a function of time, and I have shown you that when the duty cycle was reduced, the ion flux in the on period decreases very rapidly, and because the ion current is decreasing, the ion energy in the on period is going to increase. And my conclusion here is that in synchronized pulse plasma at low duty cycle, the wafer is bombarded by very energetic ions. So I will now summarize and conclude my talk. So basically, I have first looked at the impact of pulsing parameters on the plasma chemistry, and I have shown you that the duty cycle was very interesting to control the radical flux to the wafer, and that it allowed us to reach some new domains of plasma chemistry. So there are some drawbacks because the chemical reactivity is reduced. Some polymerizing plasma can become less polymerizing. I leave this open for questions eventually. Then the next step was to look at the ion flux and energy, and in a typical CW-ICP, you can control the energy of the ion, but in a restricted energy range. You don't have access to the low energy nor to the high energy region. But now, if you pulse the ICP only without power, we can access to the low energy region, and this has already allowed us to reduce damages during etching of very thin layers. And if you use synchronized pulse plasmas with some bias power, you can now access to the high energy region, which is certainly interesting to improve profile control. And my final conclusion here is that by pulsing the plasma, basically the range of operation of ICP can be broadened from something like downstream etching conditions with very low flux of low energy ions, and it can be broadened also on the other hand to capacitively coupled like plasma etching conditions with very energetic ions at a low flux. And that's it. Thanks for your attention.
Yeah, thank you for this perfectly timed talk. So we have time for questions.
Yes. Yes. In your pulse plasma measurement, where you looked at the decay also of the radical density, did you analyze whether that radical density actually decreased exponentially, or did you see a different behavior?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. So I would say that we have measured many radicals with the technique. And I would say that all of them, almost all of them decay exponentially. There is one exception, it's this one. So it's a chlorine atom density, and it's non-exponential, actually. So it's what we think is that it may be due to the fact that the recombination reaction on the chamber wall is not, it may be a second order on chlorine density, actually. So it may decay at 1 over T, instead of an exponential decay.
Yeah, because that's what I would expect. Because you have, of course, chlorine adsorbed on the wall, but because you're really pulsing on-off, it means actually that the surface, let's say, coverage of chlorine changes also. So you would get a non-linear, let's say, decay time.
Yeah, that's exactly
what you would expect.
Yeah, that's exactly what we see. But on the other end, I don't have the data here, but if we do the same measurement in HBR, the decay of HBr and the rise of the bromine atom is perfectly exponential. So it depends on the radicals, actually.
Would you not, let's say, mitigate this if you would only do a small, amplitude of pulsing? So you have a continuous discharge and you just
modulate
a small addition, so to stay in the linear regime.
So yeah, it's a very interesting point.
I will show you that.
Yeah, maybe we can. maybe we'll have a look. Okay, because it was interesting to see that it was non-exponential in the case of chlorine. So thanks for the idea. I keep it in mind.
So you showed your UV absorption with the chopper, and you showed the background for O versus O2, I think it was. And one of them, it seems to take a very long time to decay. It doesn't even settle to some background.
I could not go really into the detail of this. I didn't get enough time. Actually, the explanation is this decay, which is puzzling for you, isn't it? It was puzzling for us as well at the beginning. Actually, what it means is that a significant part of the background here is coming from the beam. So when you shut down the beam, there is this background which comes from the previous pulse, and you have to pump it out of the mass spectrometer head. And what you see here is a decay of the background that is due to the beam, but that is pumped out by the turbo here. So this is the pumping time. And it means that it's important actually because some people made mistakes when doing mass spec measurements. It means that the background must be estimated at this point, just after the chopper has shut down the beam. If you leave too much time, the background is pumped and you will underestimate the background. So you really have to do this measurement and to measure it just when the beam is shut down.
Question just for the slide you were looking at before with the chlorine density and the molecular chlorine density.
Which one?
Yeah, just that looking at the molecular chlorine density, when you turn the pulse on, the density crashes in the first few microseconds, or what's that process then? The blue line dips by 25% and then starts to decay.
Yeah, so this is, there are many things going on actually when you strike the power hole. So the most obvious thing which takes place on a time scale of about 1 millisecond is electron impact dissociation. It's very fast. And at the same time, you also have gas heating, which is in some way flushing the chlorine to the bottom of the chamber. And then what's going on is that because you have gas heating and dissociation, the pressure rises above its steady state, and then the system is going to react here to go to steady state pressure, and that's why it's decay with two different times constant. So this is dissociation and heating, and this is the pressure which is moving.
Dissociation, so I said, doesn't correspond to an increase in the chlorine.
Yeah, you're right, because this is measured by absorption spectroscopy in very near from the inductive part, a few centimeters below the ICP antenna, and this is measured by mass spectrometry near the reactor walls. That's why. It's not measured at the same position.
I have one question regarding to your ultramolecular spectroscopy. So, did you see any resonance line there, and did you examine them for
atoms, you mean?
Yeah.
Well, we tried to do this, and we did not succeed. So we tried to develop some, for example, to detect chlorine atoms, and it's funny because the two questions are linked. Actually, we would like to measure the chlorine atom density not near the wall by mass spectrometry, but at the same position. So we try to develop some chlorine lamps that would emit a line that would be resonantly absorbed by the chlorine atoms. And we did not manage to make a good lamp, actually. It's very difficult because you don't know what is the spectral shape of the line that is going out.
It should be very narrow and usually very high intensity and very
one light. Yeah, you're right, but the problem is the absorbance then depend on the respective Doppler width of the chlorine atom in the lamp and in the plasma. And if you don't know the Doppler width of the chlorine atom in the lamp, you cannot deduce the absolute density. And then you got some self-absorption in the lamp, which means that the lamp line profile is not a nice Doppler line, it's something like this, and it's actually very difficult. We did not succeed.